Good morning to you. Last week Sunday, we had an incredible celebration. Who was here last week Sunday? Yo, we had an amazing Thanksgiving service where we just went all out giving God all the thanksgiving and praise that He deserves. And let me just say, it was just incredible to hear the testimonies coming through about, you know, what God has done in their life throughout this year, hearing so many incredible things of how God moved. And let me just say, I love that. I love that because it stirs within me to also go and say, yo, if that can happen to that person, it can happen to me. And that's what I love about that illustration that we had about writing down what you are thankful for. Remember? And we held it up. And remember, I said to you, look around and see all those who have breakthroughs in their life. Don't be like, oh, but they got a new car. So. Can you applaud them just as loud as you would receive your own vehicle? Because can I tell you, when you applaud them just as loud, you don't know where tomorrow you will receive your breakthrough. And then you need people to applaud also to say, your King Jesus is amazing because He brings breakthrough to that family's life. And so I was just really excited and it stirred within me about, you know, the Thanksgiving service. But we now in this new month and this new season, and I believe, and it's just amazing, I shared with Roxanne, when God gives me the word, because I want you to know this. When God speaks to me, and okay, let's just start there. God does speak to me. And when He shares to me about the series that I feel the church needs to go in, because we go through seasons, and I believe that this is the season of a greater harvest. And I love how God confirms that. Because it wasn't long then after then I hear about other prophets and other people, and guess what they're saying? Oh, this is a season of a harvest. This is a season of a greater harvest. And I'm like, yo, come on, God. If you speak to me, you speak to other people as well. So that's confirmation. So I believe church, Sweetwater's family, those who are visiting us, those who are watching online, we are in the season of greater harvest. And this morning, we will be unpacking this new series called Greater Harvest. And we will be teaching and equipping each and every one of you about what it means about the harvest fields. Because for those who went through the E3 or EE3 course, about the evangelism course, they will know that they talk about four fields of evangelism. And in this series, we will be unpacking those four fields. And so there is a slide up there. If you can pick that slide up for me, I would really appreciate it. There we are. So the first field is the empty field. Then the second field is the seeded field. The third field is the sprouting field or the growing field. And then the fourth field is the harvest field. And so when we talk about evangelism or going out on mission, we talk about those four fields. And in this series that we're going to be unpacking about the greater harvest, we will also be directing it back to these four fields for us to get equipped and ready for the greater harvest. And for us to understand the spiritual understanding of harvest, the spiritual understanding of the harvest in its basic form means basically evangelism. And so if you have your Bibles with you, you can turn with me to the book of Ezekiel. And I always ask and I pray that you bring your own Bibles here, just as I have my Bible here. I want you to bring your Bible. It will be on the screen, yes, but it might not be your translation. But I want you to also bring your Bible and read for yourself what the book is speaking of. So Ezekiel chapter 37, and we'll go right to verse 1. Everybody there? If you are there, just shout amen. Okay, Ezekiel 37, starting from verse 1, it says, "The hand of the Lord was upon me, and He brought me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of the valley. It was full of bones. And He led me around among them, and behold, there were very many on the surface of the valley, and behold, they were very dry." Somebody repeat, very dry. "And He said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, you know. Then he said to me, prophesy over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a sound. Somebody repeat, a sound. And behold, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. And I looked, and behold, there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. Let us pray as we prepare for God's word this morning. Heavenly Father, and Almighty God and King, we come before you, and we thank you, Lord, for just all you're doing, continue to do, Lord. And we thank you, Lord God, that as we looked at this parched land, as we look at the dry bones, as we look to your word, as you speak to us through the book of Ezekiel, let our hearts be receptive, our ears be open, and our minds be captured, Lord God, to receive what you have for each and every one of us. We thank you for all you're doing, continue to do. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. As I said, we're going to be unpacking the four fields that we're going to be talking about evangelism. We talk about the greater harvest. And the first field I want to really touch on is the empty field. The empty field. And so, in our introductory passage, Ezekiel was led through a parched valley. And he wondered how many lives had been lost. Everywhere he looked, there seemed to be endless piles of bones, without any sign of life. Now, let me just say, these weren't just bones, and you repeated it because that's why I wanted you to repeat that, because it was dry bones. It wasn't just like bodies laying on the field, bodies lying in the valley. It was dry bones. A violent battle had taken place, leaving many corpses behind, but decomposition and wild animals had taken their toll, so that these dry bones was the only remains that was left after all this. And then comes the question that God then tells or asks Ezekiel, can these bones live? Now, no doubt this was a difficult question to answer. Let me just say this, because if Ezekiel says no, that means that he doesn't really trust or believe in the power of God. If he says yes, that means he's like, yo, this is a crazy, crazy thing that is happening. I have to believe that God can do the supernatural through these bones. And so this is a difficult, difficult question to answer. And I wonder how many of us would answer God if God asked us that same question. What would be our immediate reaction? Because let's just be real for a moment. Like I said, this valley wasn't just laid out there with bodies. It was dry bones. They've been left there for a long, long time. There was no skin, no organs, nothing besides disconnected skeletons. And they weren't just bones. They were dry bones, meaning they were there for a long time, like I said. There's literally nothing living in that valley. And almost like, you know, who watch Western movies? Who likes Western movies? Okay, that's five of us. Okay, I didn't have my hand up. So that's four of you. But remember now, if you those who watch Westerns, you know, like they have that little woo-hoo, that whistle sound, like, you know, like as a Western. I can't whistle like that. I tried, can't. Yeah, that one. I'll use you for my background music later. But then you like have the tumbleweed coming across. And then you're like, yo, that's like, you know, like how we always speak, that's like a one-horse town. and even the horse is dead. But it's like dry and nothing is happening. And that's almost like, because I like to picture, like when I read the Word of God, I like to picture how this place will look like. And then the only reference I can have is like a Western movie, like seeing this valley, seeing this town where there's nothing, absolutely nothing but the dry bones. And then now Ezekiel has to answer God, because God is still waiting for him to answer. And I love what Ezekiel says. Oh Lord God, you know. Oh Lord God, you know. Almost like it's a safe play. Like, I can't say yes or no, I'm just going to say you know. So Ezekiel says, you know. But then God gives Ezekiel a strange command. And he says, prophesy over these bones. Prophesy over these bones. Now, let me just make it clear why I say this is a strange request, even in the Bible. Because literally, I've preached to myself in the mirror. Yeah, I've done that. Just to look at what I look like. You know, keep your stomach in. Don't show them. You know, smile sometimes, because otherwise it looks like you're always angry. So then I'm like, always have to like check myself in the mirror. Like, what do I look like when I preach? So then I preach to the mirror. And I've preached to the car that took my parking spot even, because let's just be clear, he needs Jesus. But let me just be honest. I've never, ever preached to dry bones. I've never prophesied to dry bones. I remember, for those who've been part of Embrace Grace for many years, Pastor Fabian Jude once came here from Embrace Grace. He's the senior pastor of Planet Shakers South Africa. And I love that one, you know, that he spoke about. And he said, you know, when before he went into ministry, he was a part of a church. And then he would go, like, when the church is empty, when there is nobody, he would literally preach to the chairs. He would literally go, let me go here because there's some empty chairs here. He would literally go and he would be like, you know, he would be preaching to the chair. He would be like, then he would just take the chair and he would kick it down. He's like, ah, sha-da-da-da-da. And he would like, because he's like now prophesying to that chair, because that chair needs deliverance right now. And he just goes, fire, fire. But the chair is empty. There's nothing. And he'll go to the next chair. Fire, fire. And he preaches whole heart out to the empty chair. And everybody's like laughing, like we're doing, like, what, the man is crazy. Why is he doing that? Can I tell you why he was preaching to the empty chair? Because it was preparing for when the chair is full. See, you need to be prepared that even when the place is empty, that you are getting yourself ready for when the harvest is coming. Because every empty chair has a bum that needs to sit on it. Yes, Pastor Kali said bum. Because that's true story. Every chair has a person. Every person has a name. Every name has a vision. And so you need to prepare yourself, even if it looks silly, that you need to preach to the emptiness. Because you don't know when God is going to bring the greater harvest in your life. He is setting you up for greater things, but he needs to test you if you can do the things that looks a little bit silly. Because can you imagine the prophet Ezekiel when God is saying to him, prophesy to the bones. You have to read between the lines, because it wouldn't say that. But I can only imagine Ezekiel looking at God like, yo, what is this oak asking me? This is dead bones, Lord. They're not going to listen to what I'm about to say. They can't understand my message. Bones cannot say amen if the point is good. They can applaud. They can't do anything. So there's silence even when you're preaching. And Ezekiel is looking at this strange request. So God is saying, prophesy to these bones. And here's the radical part about it, because prophesying means that you're speaking into somebody's life. And so when you are prophesying to an empty chair, you might not realize this, but you don't know that person that's going to be sitting in that chair that you're already prophesying over their lives. You're saying, this empty chair, I don't know who that person is, but I declare right now that he will bring somebody into his life where they will worship God. There will be breakthrough in this chair because there was sickness, but right now I declare healing. I prophesy healing over this chair. You don't know when you are prophesying to emptiness how that will radically transform a community. Humanly speaking, it is very strange when you get this request to speak or prophesy over dry bones. Because honestly, we might not say this, but we think it. What good is this to declare the word of the Lord to those who are dead? I mean, they're dead. Why do I have to speak the word of God over dead bodies? They're gone. They're dead. Let me just park there. Turn with me to Ephesians 2, verse 1. Because we're going to now speak about what it actually means about being dead. Ephesians 2, 1 says, and you, repeat after me, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. See, here Paul is actually telling to the church of Corinth or Ephesians, you were dead, meaning you were dead. You're gone. He uses the language of dead men and women, meaning unconverted men and women that are dead. Even though they physically are alive, you can say they are the walking dead. They might be arguing and talking and even agreeing and disagreeing, but the fact is they are dead. That is what Paul is basically telling. They are dead. Not physically dead, but spiritually dead. Nothing is happening in their life. Now, let's just be very clear quickly. Because I don't want to park too long, but I need to just define this. Because oftentimes, I see this sometimes when we fill in forms and we say what religion we are. We're like, we're Christian. Okay, when did you give your life to the Lord? No, I was born Christian. Now, let me just say this. You are not born a Christian. If you've done it, okay, I'm not judging you, but just understand this. You are not born a Christian. We are born sinners. You're not born a Christian. So let me just illustrate this. You're like, yeah, but I was born in a family that are Christian, so I'm automatically a Christian. Okay? Just because you're born in a hospital doesn't make you a doctor. Hashtag just saying. No, be careful. You're not born a Christian. We have to receive Jesus to become a Christian. We have to make the decision to say, Jesus, I want you to come into my life and I will faithfully just worship you and you alone. That is what a Christian is. You're not born a Christian. You become a Christian. And so prior to that, guess what? What we were dead. Before we had a relationship with Jesus, we were dead. And that is what Paul is saying to the Ephesian church, in saying, you were dead. But I love this because it doesn't stop there. If you go a few verses on to verse 8 in the same chapter of Ephesians, it says, because this is how the change happens. Not because you were born physically, but you were almost a rebirth happened. Born again. So Ephesians 2 verse 8 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. So it's not that you are born because your family came to church every Sunday. It is through faith, believing, trusting in God as your Savior. But go with me because I'm going somewhere. I promise you I'm going somewhere. I'm trying to draw the parallel between Ezekiel's dry bones and understanding this whole thing about what faith really means and what it needs to do in our lives. So just go with me, because how do we know, how do we understand faith? How do we receive faith? Do you go to Pick and Pay and say, do you have a special on faith? No. Because even Romans speaks about it, how to receive faith. Romans 10:17 says, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So you don't go to Pick and Pay to get onto the special of faith. Buy one, get another one free. It doesn't work that way. You have to really open your ears to hear the word of God. And through the word of God, you receive an increase of your faith. I'm going somewhere with this, because now you're asking me, what is this dry bones got to do with this whole thing about the new dispensation, about understanding faith? Well, what did God say to Ezekiel? Prophesy to these bones. So he's speaking into a valley that was dry, where they haven't heard the word of God. So he's uttering, he's speaking the fullness of the word of God. And so now they're hearing. Yes, they dry bones, but they're hearing something that they never heard before. An empty field, now hearing something, the word of God. And so however strange this command was from God, Ezekiel listens to this command. He obeys it. And so he preaches, the bones begin to shake. They come together to form fully connected skeletons. Tendons and muscles begin to form. And finally covered with skin. Instead of bones, they are now full human bodies. And here's the thing. How will your co-workers hear unless you proclaim the word of God? How will your family believe unless you tell them about God? How will your friends hear without someone declaring the good news of the gospel? How will every tribe, tongue, and nation call on him if we, me and you, don't go out? We have to do this. We have to preach to the valley. We have to preach to the empty field. And I know, because when I was working through this word of God about Ezekiel's bones, as God was almost directing me through this, and I'm navigating through this message, and I was saying, but God, this is Ezekiel's bones. People often speak about Ezekiel's bones to speak about their testimony, to speak about, I need to speak about my dry bones. That's my valley, my dry bones. No, go look at it again. It is not Ezekiel's bones. It is not even his valley. So God is directing you to a place, what might not be his place, but it's a place where people still need to hear the word of God. Now, there's nothing, let me just stop there. There's nothing wrong to use that, to say, but I need to speak. Because yes, there might be some dry seasons in your life. So yes, speak to your dry bones. But at the same time, can you speak to some other dry valleys in other places instead of just your situation? Speak to your valley. Speak to your workplace. Speak to your school. Speak to your neighborhood. Speak to your community, because there's a world that needs to hear about Jesus. If you only speak to yourself, nobody's going to listen. I'm just being honest. But if you speak to a community that needs to hear Jesus, there's ears to hear. And what did I say? They receive faith by hearing the word of God. But here's the thing. Now they are full human bodies, but they're not alive yet. Those bodies haven't been activated yet. These dry bones now have been covered by sinew, muscle, and skin. They look the part, but they're not alive yet. Ooh, let me park there. There's many people that look the part, but they haven't been activated in the Spirit of God. Can I say that again? For those who might be hearing even online, there's many of us that look the part, We come here, we do the balala thing, we say hallelujah 5 times, 3 times amen. But then we go home and we do some crazy things that is against God. We still go onto that website that is not good for us. We still abuse our wife. We still have that affair going on. But we look the part, because as long as I can look the part in church, it's okay. It's not okay. Let me just say, it's not okay. Because it's not about just looking the part. It is about it being activated by God to do the things that He has called you for. And so there's people that look the part. But I didn't just want people that look the part. I want people to be activated by God. And that's why God is saying, I see these bodies. They look the part. But they've not been activated yet. So the job is not finished yet. Don't go away, Ezekiel. You're not done yet. There's still work to do here. Because here's the thing. Just as a body cannot survive without oxygen, a Christian cannot survive without the Holy Spirit. I'm just being honest. You cannot say you're a Christian, but you don't have the Holy Spirit. Because here's the thing about a transformative life. That the moment you accept Jesus into your life, guess what? The Holy Spirit makes His life in you grow from strength to strength. He almost makes His home in you. That's why the scripture says that Jesus, before He left His earthly ministry, He says, stay here because I will send you a comforter. That means the moment you accept Jesus, there's something that happens in your life. You've been activated. And so the Lord tells us again once again to prophesy. But this time to the breath. Ezekiel obeys another strange request, and breath begins to enter these lifeless bodies. This pile of bones become a mighty army. Where they were just bodies, now they are an army, because now they are warriors. Because you see, if you understand the spiritual dynamic that happens here, they talk about the Ruach, which is the very breath of God, the breath of the Holy Spirit. So when God is telling Ezekiel, prophesy the breath, He's actually saying, prophesy the Holy Spirit over these bodies so that life can come into this lifeless body. And so He breathes into them. Because the word must be proclaimed, but the Spirit must also come and bring to the spiritually dead something fresh, something new. Jesus teaches in John 3 that a person must undergo a change that is so radical that it's like being born again. And let me just say, only the Spirit can bring such a dramatic change to be born again. Martin Lloyd-Jones puts it this way. It is God who does it, but He does it by giving us the truth. And by giving us the Holy Spirit who enables us to understand the truth and apply it. The work of the Spirit is to bring us into this relationship to the truth by opening our eyes to it, by giving us a desire to practice it, and by enabling us to do so. But He sanctifies us through the truth. That is what the purpose is of the Holy Spirit. Let me just say this. I know, like, I see sometimes, and if you don't feel judged, that's you, please. But where's my phone? We love Facebook, eh? And whenever we have good news, we go on Facebook. Like, went to gym 5 times. Went on holiday 6 days. And so we put it on our status. We talk about Facebook because it goes out. Because there's good news to share to everybody. Because God is doing something in our lives. God is giving me a breakthrough. God is doing this and all of that. There's nothing wrong with that. That's good news. But here's the incredible thing about this whole idea about understanding good news. because we don't have to encourage ourselves to share good news when there's good news in our lives. We literally go on Facebook and we type it, and then it's great because it goes all out. We put it even on our WhatsApp status because we want everybody to be part of that conversation. But surely, surely there's no better news or good news than the one that saved my soul. Because I wonder, and again, this is not a judgmental situation. I just don't want you to feel condemned. I'm just speaking here what I need to speak. But I wonder how many of us share our status about what God is doing in our lives and saying, "Yo, God, you are so good. God, you're just doing incredible things in my life." You see, here's the thing. To evangelize means simply to share good news. And the Greek word for evangelize basically means the word angel, which means messenger. And to bring this into understanding why we say that the word angel is basically the same as evangelize and messenger, when the angel announced the birth of Jesus to the shepherds in that first Christmas, he came to evangelize them. He says, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people." So this angel was actually already evangelizing to the people of this world, saying, "I'm bringing good news." He didn't have to put a Facebook status or a WhatsApp status or anything like that. He literally just shared the good news. What is the good news? Jesus. You literally just have to say Jesus. You literally have to just preach and say the goodness of Jesus. You literally have to just ask a community, "Do you know Jesus? Can I share the good news of Jesus? Can I bring you into a relationship with Jesus? Can I talk about my good friend, Jesus? Can I tell you who saved my soul? Jesus." Literally, that's all you have to do is have a conversation, because that is the good news. So you literally are just a messenger for when God is sending you into an empty field to speak about the good news, which is?
Jesus.
Which is?
Jesus.
See, we got evangelists already. So here's the incredible thing about being a messenger. You don't have to rewrite the story. The story has already been written. You don't have to come up with some crazy, far-fetched story. You literally just have to say, "Jesus is alive. He's active in my life. Can I show you? Can I pray for you? Can I help you to be in a better relationship with Jesus?" The band can start making their way to the stage. The command to go into the world and share the good news is just as impossible as trying the dry bones to come to life. Because yes, it's difficult sometimes to go into a foreign place, to go into a place where it feels unfamiliar, where it feels it's spiritually dead. Because let's be honest, I'd rather just come here to where it's cozy, the aircon is on, people are already saved, I don't have to do much effort, much work, because it's nice. But you see, God has not called us to be comfortable. God has not called us to just be comfortable in how we share the good news. Because we are not here just here. You cannot evangelize in church. Let me just say that. I feel I need to say this. You cannot evangelize in church. You're literally preaching to the saved. And I know there's an oxymoron because I'm literally preaching to you right now. But I'm doing a teaching more. But you cannot try and evangelize somebody in this church right now. I'm just being honest. You can bring them into having a family church and say, "Oh, that's great." But there's a community out there that we need to reach. And the only way we're going to reach them is to go out there. Not saying, "Hey, you have to come first year." Doesn't work that way. We have to go out there to the dry bones, to the valley of the dry bones, to the empty field out there that says they don't have sinew, they don't have muscles, they don't have the Word of God yet in their life. The Spirit of God have not yet been activated in their life. And I pray that God is speaking to you right now in this morning. Can these dry bones live? Because if you're going to see a community where God needs to go into the community, where people need to be reached, I pray that you hear God actively speaking to you and giving you this one command to say, prophesy to these dry bones. Because He's calling you this morning, children. He's calling you this morning to say, you need to be a messenger of the good news. You need to go into the community to speak to those dry bones, because there's still a place that needs to hear the good news. There's still people that needs to be saved. There's still people that needs to go to heaven. I don't know about you, but I don't want anybody to go to hell. I'm just saying, I know that, you know, when I say this, some people tentatively say, oh, but you don't know that other person. Yeah, I don't know that other person. But I know God still loves that person. And if God still loves that person still has a home. And that home is still heaven. Because that's why the scripture says, I go to my Father's place to prepare a room for you. And I pray that we get to that place where we can say to somebody, not just at funerals, but in communities where there needs to be life, to say, my God is preparing a room for you. Do you know my God? Do you know my God? His name is Jesus. Can I share the good news of Jesus to you? That's all you have to do. You just speak about how Jesus saved your life. Can these bones live? I pray this morning we'll answer the call by saying, oh Lord God, you know. You know. The Bible says in Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, the people perish. What is your vision for your life? Not for the church, but for your life. I know what is the vision for the church, but is what is your vision? Why are you living here on earth, assuming that you are living? God's vision for your life will always be aligned with His commission. Let me just say that again, because I think somebody needs to hear this. God's vision for your life will always be aligned with His commission, meaning that He will commission you to do great exploits for Him, meaning He will send you to the nations, meaning He will ask you to preach the good news, because that is His commission. Matthew 28 speaks about this. Meaning, yes, we are to worship God, but we're also here to be His messengers of His good news. And so this morning, I want you to just receive what God has, to speak into your life, so that you can be speaking into the valley of the dry bones, the empty field that needs to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Can I ask you to stand this morning? As I said, this place here, this auditorium here, this family church here is a refueling station, basically, for us to get refueled, re-energized, and get ready for going out. And maybe your refueling, maybe your re-energizing moment is actually, Lord, I'm not speaking to dry bones right now, because right now I am that dry bone. Maybe I am that dead body right now. Maybe I need to hear the good news first for myself before I can actually go out and share the good news. And so I don't want anybody looking around. This is a moment between you and God, not your neighbor, not your friend, your wife, your spouse, nobody. That's just between you and God right now. This is a serious moment, because this is the defining moment between you making the decision. Remember, I said you cannot be born a Christian. You actually have to make the decision to become a Christian. And maybe you need to actually make the decision this morning. So I want you, if that is you, maybe it's your first time giving your life to Jesus. Maybe you've given your life to Jesus before, but something happened. Maybe there's some things that happened that left you a little bit disappointed, hurt, and broken. And you could see yourself pulling away from God. Instead of being closer to God, you were pulling away from God. And maybe this morning you need to come back. The prodigal son and daughter needs to come back home. I don't know if you are the prodigal, but God is calling you home. And so if that is you, can I ask you just quickly, nobody looking around, just quickly, if that is you, can I just ask you just to quickly lift your hands. Just lift your hands to the heavens. Just lift your hands. There's many people. You can put your hand down. Put your hands down. We're all going to say this prayer together. Not just those who put their hands up, but all of us need Jesus. Those who put their hands up, I would just gracefully ask that afterwards you speak to one of our section hosts or at the info desk to one of our deacons just to receive a red card. Basically, the red card basically just means a salvation card. Basically, it's just information so that we can give you resources for giving your life to Jesus. What does it mean for the next steps of your life? Because this is a journey that you're going to be taking on where God is just going to move mightily in your life. And so we're going to just repeat after me this prayer. Thank you, Father, for your Son, Jesus, that died on the cross for all my sins, past, present, and future. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that I am born again. That my old life is no longer part of my new life. Holy Spirit, will you just fill me up afresh? Fill me up anew. I make you Lord and Savior of my life. King Jesus. Forever. Amen. Give a round of applause for